Folks, let's get started. Let me share something with you. When I met Gabe back in 2006, 2007, it really changed my life because I really got to understand how the power of diversity. But I'm going to start off with a story that just happened to me about 5 months ago that was really personal to me. I went and did a conference, I went and did a talk in a state. I'm not going to tell you the state because it's really not important where the state was. I had just finished talking to an audience like this, probably a smaller audience. And as I was walking out of my room at the end of the day, there was this lady waiting for me. And she says, "Ray, can I talk to you?" And I said, "Uh-oh." I was concerned. I said, did I offend you? Because when the lady came up to me, she had tears in her eyes. And she says, "Ray, now think of this. She's got tears in her eyes. And she says, "Do you like to hunt?" And I'm getting kind of nervous. And I said, "Yeah," because I was thinking in my mind, am I going to be the hunted one? And she says, "Ray, I heard your talk, and I was bothered." And I said, "Well, what's wrong?" She says, "I am married into a family that we own 25,000 acres. And I have to work outside the house to provide medical insurance for my family. We have four brothers. And you know what we did? We went and took all the fence out, sold all the cattle. We went from no-till to conventional. And in front of our house is filled with red equipment." Because she knew intuitively that was the wrong thing to make that family not only sustainable, but regenerative. And it was personal. I couldn't help feel bad that it was emotional. It was personal to me too, because it impacted her. As it impacts that family, it impacts all of us. Because there's a silent suffering going on in this country where there's financial burden, a stress upon our producers that is incredibly overwhelming. Today, I'm going to share with you how we can reduce that stress, how we can emulate nature, and how we can farm and understand its synergies. I'm going to humbly submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, that agriculture was built on the wrong foundation. When I go across the country, I ask this question, and I'm going to ask you today. How many of you had a cousin, maybe a relative, an uncle, an aunt, a grandparent, a professor, a mentor, somebody special in your life will say to you, if you're going to farm and ranch, your job is to emulate it, to understand it, to nurture it, to understand its complementaries and its synergies. Not to force it, not to have dominion over it with our tools of tillage, fungicides, herbicides, all those tools. Please don't misunderstand me. I didn't say not to use the tools, but to understand it and to use those tools in wisdom. How many of you were taught that way? Raise your hand. Very few. I did that at PASA, the organic group. I have noticed as I go all over the country, I humbly submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, agriculture was built on the wrong foundation. Even our sciences were not asking the right question. Not how to make it more productive, but how to mimic it. I'm going to show you with these two demonstrations, I think, are probably the most powerful, very powerful demonstrations. So I'm going to ask the Jennings ladies come up. Mr. Jennings offered to have his daughters help me, very lovely young ladies. I do not go anywhere in the country to teach without these demonstrations. To me, too much time wasted. I have to have quickly connect. We're going to show you how these two demonstrations, with these two demonstrations, ladies and gentlemen, I had one person in the audience convert 30,000 acres into cover crops and no-till. Watching the demonstrations and learning. This test is called the aggregate stability test and the slake test. Can everybody see? Okay? Now, I think maybe we just hope we didn't give Willie too much coffee and he doesn't shake too much, but I think he's doing good. Okay. Here's the way the test works. This information has been around for a long time, and is what really bothers me. When I went to graduate school for soils and my undergraduate, none of this was taught to me, and it really bothered me. But we are now teaching people, and we're changing people's lives by these demonstrations. Now, here's the first one. You're going to hold this one, Catherine. Catherine's going to hold soil. Well, I'll put these soils right here. Can you put them right here, Willie? Can you see them? These are the same soils from North Carolina. My right hand is a 40-year no-till. It's by Ray Stiers. That organic matter is 6.5%. Before Europeans entered North Carolina, the soils were 3%. He's at 6 to 6.5%. The soil on the left is a mile apart, conventional, same soils, Cecil sandy clay loams. Typical organic matter in the North Carolina is 0.5% to 1%. And no-till with poor rotations, maybe 2%. Ray at 6.5%. Interesting thing about Ray soils is that he no longer buys inorganic nitrogen. He has not used phosphorus in 9 years. He's gone from 5 herbicides down to 1 herbicide. I said, Ray, you could be organic no-till. And he's 83 years old. He says, Ray, we're both talking to each other. Can you imagine the conversation? Ray. I said, Ray, you could get big bucks for your corn. He said, Ray, I don't even buy green bananas because I might not live it long enough to enjoy them. And we wanted to go to organic. I said, okay, whatever. Hey, what can you say when somebody's doing such a good job, right? Now, I collect soils. Nicole's going to hold Oklahoma conventional. And in her right hand, go ahead, ladies, stand behind there if you want. Or you good? Just where you can reach it. That's great. On Nicole's right hand is Ohio. The rotation on that one is soybean. And then you, in between the soybean, tillage. Okay? Now, this is the way the test works. You get the, and you can do this on your own house. In fact, you can do this in your garden, okay? It's pretty simple. You collect some clods from your soil, some peds, let them air dry. You can even stick them in the microwave. Prefer you just let them air dry in the garage. So the way it works is we're gonna drop the clods into the water. We're gonna gently drop them into the water. We wanna see which of the clods hold their integrity. We don't want it to fall apart because in each clod, there are millions and millions of pore spaces. Water's going to rush in to fill the pore space. And internal pressures are going to build up. When the soil, if the soil starts to slake, break apart, that is an indicative that the pores are beginning to collapse. And if the pores collapse, no porosity, no infiltration. It is an indicator that the biotic glues, the organomineral complexes created by biology, the fungus, the bacteria, the root exudate, all this elegance working together to create the structure, the pore space, and some chemistry. Let's see what happens. But before I want to make a caveat, this test works on 95 to 98% of the soils. Some soils just will not slake because of mineralogy. Now, please remember, it is one indicator. Just like you, you're very complex. The doctor checks many indicators. Blood pressure, fecal samples, saliva. You're complex. This is one indicator. Ladies, let's gently drop them in. Excellent. Notice, and I love collecting soils from all over the country, because if I just bring North Carolina soils to Tennessee or to the state, they will say, man, Ray, it sucks to live in North Carolina. And it says, no, this is happening all over. I've done this in Puerto Rico, Alaska, Hawaii. The same things occur. Look at Ray's soil, how it's holding together, how the biotic glues, those organo-mineral complexes. Those glues typically last about 27 days in the soil ecosystem. They have to be continually replenished by liquid carbon. We'll talk about that later in a little while. Look at here, the ones that are falling apart. North Carolina, Oklahoma, Ohio. This is happening all over the globe where we do tillage. Let's make it very clear. Tillage is one of the most intrusive things we do in modern agriculture. You disrupt the habitat. So how does that happen? As you run that disc, remember, the highway department uses the disc because it destroys organic matter, and they want to make a concrete pad. The disc is brutal. So when you till, you wake up these bacteria called R. strategist. They're opportunists, or copatrophic bacteria. They are there and designed to be put in the system. They are opportunists. They are a quick metabolic rate. That's what R. strategist. It's like a teenager when you say pizza, man, they're ready to eat. The moment you till, within hours, you wake them up, they start consuming the organic matter you work so hard to build. Tillage is intrusive. And this is the reason why one of the reasons why our water cycle is not working. We can no longer afford this because it is causing families to lose the farm and ranch, and it is changing and impacting every aspect of our lives, our health, our weather. Let's go to the next demonstration. Ladies, get that little jug. See, they practiced. Come right here, line up so they can see. Now, this lady, Catherine, she's the tillage. Just think of her as heavily disturbed. I mean, the tillage part. Less disturbed. She liked that part. No-till. We're just going to gently pour water, and we'll see how the biotic, because how fast does a raindrop come? 15 to 20 miles an hour. We're going to show you why we have wind erosion and why our rivers, in part, look like chocolate. Go ahead and pour right on top of that. Let's see if those biotic glues are holding the tiny little bitty clays and the sand particles. The ladies don't know the one they choose they have to drink out of. Oh, life sucks, Catherine, huh? Man, I don't want that. That might have a little bit of glyphosate, though. What do you think about that? Yeah. I tell my organic farmers, it's not about having wars on the tools. It's about understanding the tools and using them with wisdom. Look at this. Please understand, ladies and gentlemen, that's awesome. Great, you're a great rain cloud. We can stop now. Show them close, get closer to Willie so he can show. When the biotic glues are gone, the clays will fly. We will have massive wind erosion. We will have our rivers filled like chocolate. The biotic glues are not intact. Who would have thought that the completion of the water cycle was connected to the microbes? Everything is connected. Everything is one. Very critical principle to learn. Beautiful, ladies. Now, would you give these lovely ladies a hand? Aren't they amazing? Thank you, ladies. And you did it well. Thank you. Now, Doug, now this is called the rain simulator. How many have seen this? Isn't that awesome? I never get tired of seeing this. It is. We really should call it the model of the water cycle and the carbon cycle. We're going to show you what a diminished carbon cycle leads to a diminished water cycle. This is happening all over the earth. This is what the majority of our climate is being impacted. Please remember, you cannot have climate without soil and water. Cannot have it. Now, here, I'm going to show you the... Is Willie? Huh? Can you? Yeah, I'm going to tell him. Come here. Tell him what we are here.
Soil types. full series. This would be a short-term hooktail, a couple of years residue. And then we don't know the difference between these two right now because Doug hid the markings, but these are both fescue pastures. One's been managed grazing for almost 40 years. One's been managed grazing for about four. And then, of course, we have our overgrazed tall fescue pasture here, long-term continuous grazing. Soil types are cecils and packlets, similar to what they dropped in the slaking test, so sandy clay loams.
Let's give Philip a hand for getting this collection. It's a lot of work. And Doug Peterson, thank you, Doug. It's a lot of work. They did this because they love you, man. That's what they did this for. Okay, here we go. I'm going to show you the conventional. What do we typically do? We run our tillage machine, loosen it up because we want to make it fluffy to allow more air to go in, right? Right? All of us were taught that way. We were all taught that way. Now, notice the nature right here. Look at the no-till has a covering. Look at the sod inside the sod. Can you get it? All good, healthy ecosystems always have armor in the system. No-till, look at the grass. You will find them in forests. That's called the detritus sphere. Always having armor or having vegetation. Look at some of our organic farms and our conventional systems. Okay? Now, let's make it rain. Looks pretty good. Okay. What? Say it again. Where are we? Well, it's interesting. Once you bring your soils healthy, it helps diminish the drought. What I'm going to show you is a diminished water cycle. As this rain is coming down, a lot of us say, we're praying for rain. What we should be doing is praying that we restore our soils because we know we can't bring the rain, can we? We don't know when we're going to get the rain. But it's all how you manage your tools and your cattle. If you overgraze, you diminish that water cycle. As you can see already, Willie, you got it right here? Look how, just in a couple of minutes, look what's happening to that soil, that conventional. And think of the millions and millions of acres throughout the globe that tillage is still the major way that we farm. And what is happening to the water cycle? The thing people don't realize, as the water runs off, the water has to go in the soil. A lot of our conservation is you put diapers at the end. So in other words, right here, we would have a diaper. We would be tilling within the terrace, but we did a buffer. We put a buffer out there, but yet we're still tilling between the terrace and you destroy the aggregate stability and the cottage cheese. Ladies and gentlemen, proactive conservation is when you address it the moment the raindrop lands right there. If you do not take care of it right there, everything else is a diaper and reactive conservation. Ready? A little longer? You want to run a little longer? Now notice real quick, before Doug turns it off, I want you to notice on the backdrop here how it's beginning to splash. When those particles are disassociated and comes and detaches, it lands on the plant, and then all of a sudden you have disease in your cotton. You have disease in your soybean. You have disease in your tomato plants. Because those particles there, and you get a bacteria. And you have an infection site. Look at how it disassociates. Notice also the soil also in the overgrazed pasture. Let's go ahead and shut it up, Doug. I think it proved our point. Now, these soils in Georgia are pretty sandy, correct? That one that you had, the conventional?
Right. There'll be sandy clay loams from Piedmont.
Okay, good. Let's turn this thing off. Then let's see how much we got. Look how much ran off. Look how much infiltrated. When I go to Eastern Colorado, they say, we can't afford to grow cover crops, Ray. We don't have enough water. Maybe the fact is your soil is so destroyed, it can't take anything in and won't infiltrate. And then because it's so hot, a lot of it evaporates because we have a dysfunctional soil. And yet we blame the cover crops. Notice also the no-till. Look how much ran off, and look how much infiltrated. And how many times have we heard no-till, no yield? But see, ladies and gentlemen, no-till is not enough. It never was enough. No-till with covers changes everything. No-till stops the destruction of the soil structure, but it does not feed the system. It is covers that feed the system. No-till is not enough. Now, let's look at the path. These both properly managed grass systems. Look how much infiltrated. Look how much ran off. Now, same thing happened to the other one. I'm not going to show you that one. Now, this is always amazing to me, grazers. Look how the cow can be a very destructive tool. It's not the cow. It's the understanding of the person managing the cow. Look how much ran off, and look how much infiltrated. And then guess what we do? We'll go buy chemical fertilizer because that paddock looks terrible. Then you take away your profit because you put it on chemical fertilizer. Because we didn't understand that we took too much solar panel. And when you take too much, now interesting about this, ladies and gentlemen, we did not till that system. We did not till it. And yet a majority of the water ran off because the soil is exposed. When you take too much solar panel, you steal from the process of making cottage cheese, aggregates. Those aggregates are what holds the clays and sands together. You take too much carbon, you hurt the system. You've got to be careful how you manage the animals. Now, let's see. Let's flip this one over. Doug, you want to flip this over? Okay. We're gonna flip this over. Doug's gonna flip it over. What I love about flipping this over is I have seen grown men cry because they say, I cannot believe this is happening to my place. Let's see how much infiltrated in that short time. Ready? Look how much, look how dry it is. And this is happening through the whole globe. Because we did not understand and how powerful the biology is. Isn't that amazing? Ladies and gentlemen, is it possible that we are creating our own droughts? I would humbly say yes. And it's changing the weather patterns. It is the soil that's diminished. Thank you, Doug. It's beautiful. Ladies and gentlemen, I am personally convinced these demonstrations, a shovel, go to the field, we can change the planet. With people with understanding and committed, we can change our situation. Ladies and gentlemen, when I go across the country, these are the principles I teach. When I walk on your operation, these things are going continuously in my mind. That with a shovel, in 30-minute conversation, I know where you're at. The first one in the center. Think, now there's four principles NRCS teaches. Reduce chemical biological disturbance. What that means, be careful with the fungicides. Be careful with the chemicals. Be careful with the fertilizers. Be careful with the tillage. Cover the soil all the time. Have a living root 24/7. Synergize with diversity, diversity, diversity. Synergize with it. Those are the four principles, the NRCS, but they left one out. In fact, my one's missing is incorporate animals in the system. Incorporate animals in the system. Nature does not farm without animals. Now, the other three are more important than the first four. The one in the center, the other three are human word. The others is towards the ecology. My favorite word, understand context. Context. We need to understand our psychological, our social, our cultural, spiritual, ecological context. I'll explain that in a little while. And then I added, you cannot build soil health without human integrity. You cannot build ecological integrity without human integrity. And then the other one, have a plan. It doesn't have to be a complex plan, but have a plan in your operation. Let's start down the journey. Let's make it very clear that agriculture runs on this. Agriculture runs on ancient sunlight. Organic people, everyone, every one of you, your clothes, your food, all that we do is run by this very complex system. And it is finite. And it is fragile. If something happens in the system falls apart. How many of you, raise your hand, want to depend on that, or do you want to depend on your soil? Raise your hand. That's what I thought. You're very smart. Remember what happened in Louisiana, how they tried to get water when they had that hurricane, Katrina. How long did it take the government to get water? 5 days. We're big, it's complex. Let's learn how to depend on the natural system more. When I fly all over the country, ladies and gentlemen, and I took this picture with my iPhone, it was a 2008, and I would sit there in the window seat, click, 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 and the people would ask me, what are you doing? I said, I'm looking at the landscape. Can't you see that river? It is filled with conservation plans and nutrient management plans and grazing plans. But it's not crystal clear with understanding. That's what I told the EPA. I said, EPA, look at all our plans. I was born in 1961. This is a picture where I went to college at New Mexico State University. I didn't know, ladies and gentlemen, until I saw that picture, that my state was a prairie. This is what I grew up seeing. And it's still like that today on millions and millions of acres. Notice the bare ground giving off heat. Before, after. Then in our wisdom, how they blame the animals, guess what we do? We take the animal out and we make it worse. So, how are we doing today? Ladies and gentlemen, observe. This was taken on April 6th. This is Texas. This is the whole Southwest blowing. Do you notice how our science has fixed it? We have spent trillions and trillions of dollars and we're still here. Ladies and gentlemen, we're looking and we're asking the wrong questions. Look at here how the soil looks. On the left side, you'll see this is how the Creator Farms, look at the forest, look at the soybean. It's the same soil, ladies and gentlemen. And throughout the country, there's a gradation of the two. If you look real deep on the left slide, that is a electron microscope imagery up to 9 millimeters. Look at the big pores on the one on the left, and the one on the right is a conventional system. Here's the cottage cheese I was telling you about. When I go dig in the soil, the bottom is those big aggregates. That's my cottage cheese. Look what tillage does to that soil. It destroys the habitat and the cottage cheese. No cottage cheese, no infiltration. We're also beginning to observe too much chemical nitrogen also hurts the cottage cheese. As you put too much copious amount of nitrogen, the microbes go, ooh, nitrogen, I'm gonna eat the house. And also the type of rotations hurt the cottage cheese. Let's make it very clear about tillage. I love Dr. Beck. Dr. Beck said, I want to show you the commonality of all tillage. All tillage destroys soil structure. It impacts water infiltration, diminishes it. It reduces organic matter, and it stimulates weeds. See, but when you till, those microbes die, they release nitrogen and feed the weeds. How many of you have heard about the global warming issue? Raise your hand. How many of you are sick of hearing it? Raise your hand. It's frustrating, isn't it? Because we make it, I got my slides mixed up here. What we've done and made it political, we separated the issues. On the left graph, what really started it was scientists saw CO2 going up. That reading was taken on the top of a mountain in Hawaii. They said, look at the CO2, keeps going up and up. And on the right, we have land degradation. And we have separated the issue. The problem is, it's the same issue. It's not a separate issue. Now, how has it impacted? Let me show you this little video how it has impacted our climate.
Hi, this is Bill Butler. I'm a climate scientist at NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center.
This is a NASA model. You can find it on just Google
one day
CO2.
In the Earth's atmosphere. Visualization compresses 1 year of data into a few minutes.
Notice the red plumes up there.
Carbon dioxide is the most important greenhouse gas affected by human activity.
Look at the date.
About half of the carbon dioxide emitted from fossil fuel combustion remains in the atmosphere.
Right now it's March.
While the other half is absorbed by natural land and ocean reservoirs.
Watch how we get to
the northern hemisphere. We see the highest concentrations are focused around major emission sources over North America, Europe, and Asia. Notice how the gas doesn't...
Ladies and gentlemen, even this gentleman didn't get it. What are we doing in March and April in North America? We are tilling, releasing and diminishing organic matter and releases huge plumes of CO2 into the atmosphere. Look what happens as we go into June.
Really cool. Stay in one place.
Watch the dates.
Dispersion of carbon dioxide.
Watch the colors change.
The large-scale weather patterns within the global circulation. During spring and summer in the northern hemisphere, plants absorb a substantial amount of carbon dioxide through photosynthesis.
Look how quickly our planet responds.
We see this change in the model as the red and purple colors start to fade.
Look at June. So what are we doing in June? What's happening in agriculture? It is growing and sucking the CO2. CO2 is not a poisonous gas. If it wasn't, yeah, it's not. Folks, if we did not have cows farting, if we did not have these gases, we would be Pluto. We would be like Jupiter and we would be frozen. But we don't want them all there. We want less of them and we want them in the soil. If we restore our soils 1 or 2% organic matter, we could take all the carbon that's been emitted off the last 100 years and put them in the soil. And we can feed 9 billion people. Yeah, I get so tired of hearing politicians, we gotta feed the world. No, we don't, we feed our communities and let's all teach them soil health. Then we'll feed everybody. I know, I'm an ex-Peace Corps volunteer. I lived in Guatemala. Let's teach them how to feed themselves. That makes sense. Look how it affects the temperature on our surface of our soil. The white is temperatures over 140, 160 degrees. Look at northern Africa. That used to be grassland. Now it's a desert. Is it possible if we restored our range, restored our grasslands like Ellen Savory has been saying, put cover crops at the end of the year, could we heal a lot of our issues? Absolutely. Look at our weather forecast in North Carolina last year. We got 5 inches of rain. This was North Carolina. 137, 209, on fire, we die. That's how bad. Our weather patterns have changed because we have impacted the small water cycle. This is a great book. It's free. It's called Water of the Recovery of the Climate, A New Water Paradigm. It was written by a university in Hungary, one of the groups over there, and it's just absolutely amazing because as I was going all over the country and I said, it's the soil, it's the soil. Ray, it's you, you're crazy. You smoke too many cover crops. I said, no, there's other people that think like I do. Read the 95-page document. It is phenomenal. Oh, I used my favorite word by Doug Peterson, phenomenal. Folks, this is the issue. The soil is naked, hungry, thirsty, and running a fever. See, what we have done in the science, because we just use pure science, let's make it very clear. Science is the lowest form of knowledge. It is the lowest form. It just tells you about your environment. But it does not go into the realm of the emotion, into the spiritual realm, into the personal knowing. Until this becomes personal to us, we will not change our planet. We have shown you through all the years of science and research, and look where we're at. This is a social issue. Folks, we excluded other sciences, the psychology and the social part. Let's talk about what it is. Psychology is the study of the mind and behavior. I have quickly realized as I go teach all over, until we change the human mind, we are not going to change anything. When we went to we had a cover crop conference a couple of years ago. We had a lot of the main players there. One of the researchers said, we need to have, by the end of 2020, we need to have 20 million acres of cover crops. I went and did this to my head. I said, no, that is not the measurement of success. I want 20 million minds that understand soil function. Then they will do the covers because they want to, because they understand soil function. Because if you just measure acres, did you get paid to do it? Or did you do it because you understand? You see the difference? This is why we have problems. We're measuring the wrong things. The social, we're all impacted by the social aspect. I never forgot a rancher who told me, in your own communities, we are deeply impacted. When a rancher in Idaho said, when he went first to no-till, he would go to the local store and said, and people would say, you are destroying the soil with no-till. We are social creatures and we all impact each other. And the social norms are wrong for the most part, and we have to challenge them. Here is an excellent book I recommend called The Man That Shocked the World. He uncovers the truth about human nature. It's called Obedience to Authority. It was done in 1963. And if you Google it, his name is Mr. Milgram, Stanley Milgram. He's a Jewish psychologist. And the reason I mentioned that he's Jewish, because he wanted to know how the Germans could be. Why would they allow 6 million Jews to be killed? Why didn't anybody in the military step up? What was it? So he did an incredible, sophisticated psychology study, and he found out that if people under pressure and under perceived authority, 60% of the people, more than 60% of the people, actually facilitated the experiment to hurt somebody, even all the way to administer a lethal shock that would kill the person. In other words, if people perceive that they are told to do something by authority, they will follow and they will do mindless obedience. What is happening because of our human nature, even in our own government, we are afraid to speak out because the authority says to do it this way. And we don't question it. Our human nature will mindlessly obey people and not think it out and speak out. We can no longer afford that. I recommend read the book. See, until you understand human nature, you cannot fix the natural ecosystem. This is mindless obedience in a typical community. In some communities, if you do not have bare ground, you are shunned. Am I correct? You have been shunned. Some of you that have gone to organic, haven't you been treated terribly? You're an idiot. The social pressures, the social obedience. Carl Jung said, knowing your darkness is the best method of dealing with the darkness of other people. When you combine of being sensitive and love and understand, people do what they have been taught. What we need is a massive educational program. Friedrich Nietzsche, brilliant man, very intelligent. The individual has always had to struggle to keep from being overwhelmed by the tribe. If you try it, you will be lonely often and sometimes frightened. But no price is too high to pay for the privilege of owning yourself. That's why I see some of you in here, that you own yourself and you're not willing to go to the social norm. This is Ray's view of the social aspect. It is difficult to get a man to understand something when his check depends upon it. Why are we having the problem sometimes of not spreading soul health as fast as I want? Because everybody has their own vested interest. From the researcher that taught wrong, from the government, from the neighbors, people selling chemicals, tillage, everybody has their vested interests. We ourselves have our vested interest. But if we would put the ecosystem first, we would get everything we would want. Notice how Will Harris, how he's changed the community when he changed the way he saw things. One of Gabe's favorite slides and my favorite slide is right here. Ladies and gentlemen, how do we change 7 billion minds? That's what we got to do. It's not the science. We've had the science for years. Now let's look at the ecological context. In college, I was taught this. How many of you have a soils degree? Please raise your hand. A couple. This is what we were taught. That the chemical, the physical, and the biology are all equal value. Look at the circles, same size. And everything is about organic matter. How many of you would agree with that? Raise your hand. Come on, guys, raise your hand if you agree with that. Come on, you think I'm loading you up? I am. I totally disagree with that. It is the biology that builds the aggregate, makes the organic matter, which regulates the chemistry. Let me give you an example. Look at Mars, chemical, physical. Look at the Earth, chemical, physical. What's the difference, audience? Come on. Life, bio. They are not the same equal value. Then the problem with it, when you start off with that premise, in our society, we give chemical and physical over the biology. That is what's happened to modern agriculture. We are changing that. Do you know what they teach in our grade schools? That the soil is a growing medium and it's not alive. That's unacceptable. We need to change that. It's life. Here's a great book, but Peter Donovan got me turned on. It's called The Biosphere. When I read that, I said, awesome, Dr. Vendisky. The Russians were way ahead. You know what I walked away with that book? He says the most powerful geological force on the planet is life itself. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what it's about. See if This is what we have ignored. This is a protozoa grazing around an air bubble eating bacteria. Those protozoa are part of nutrient cycling. When protozoa eat a bacteria, and because their carbon and nitrogen ratio is different, they excrete nitrogen. You can get anywhere from 17 to 117 pounds, according to Dr. Lavelle in his book, Soil Ecology. A lot of you know your body condition score of your cattle, but how do you know the body condition score of your micro herd? See, without them, you can't feed the cow. They're connected. When you take too much grass, you affect their body condition score. You don't get cycling. And then you have to go write a check to the co-op. Let's learn how to write the front of the check, not the back of the check. Look at my little grazers. I love this video by Odette Menard. See, there is a cool website called Niche Construction. We have been told through ecology that once you put organisms into a habitat, they adapt to it. That's only partially true. They also modify the habitat. They change it. Look at these earthworms. This was taken with a special camera at night in Quebec at a no-till field where no-till's not supposed to work. Look how powerful. They can take a whole forest floor down in a summer. Look at that. This is why Gabe Brown does not go to his farm by himself at night in his field. Where's Gabe? I don't know, but the dog's barking. Roof, roof, roof. They took him. They took him. And I'm telling you, you don't want to trip in his fields because they cycle very quickly. Look how they modify the soil. That is a special latex they pour down the wormhole. That's called the drillosphere. It is rich in phosphorus, rich in bacteria and nitrogen. Your corn, your soybean, your pasture, once they go, that grass goes down there, it hits the mother load. They increase the infiltration. The soils are alive. Look how I have seen them. I have seen earthworms bore into solid brick clay. That little orifice right there, that little hole, is called the drillosphere. You can go back home and talk to mama and say, look, what did you learn? Oh, I learned about the drillosphere. Cool Greek word means that wormhole. Let me show you how powerful biology is. How many of you have seen that in actual life? I have seen it because I grew up in northern New Mexico in the forests, and I say, man, how does they do that? That is a compaction issue, isn't it? So what do we do for compaction? We till. We get a big honking tractor and we till. How does that plant survive a compaction issue? Pretty simple. Now that I know, these plants are heavily mycorrhizal fungus. They excrete these incredible compounds and help break the rock down and extract the minerals. They extract the iron, the minerals from the soil, the calcium, everything. Bacteria can excrete these powerful enzymes and break the rock down. They can do it. See, when the best thing you can do to modify and get your soils and change them is life, the strongest geological force on the planet. Life does. This was taken from Australia. That is an old seabed, calcium seabed. Can you tell me, audience? Come on, audience participation, or you get no coffee. No, I'm just kidding. How come it's dark on the top? How did it get there? It's in a seabed of calcium. Life. Do you see how powerful it is? Nature wants you to approach it from a biological first, from an ecological perspective, before you come with your chemical and physical. Approach is everything. Animal behaviorists, they know approach is everything. Your soil is the same way. Let me show you some more. Now, everything we teach is really about ecology. Ecology teaches about relationship. I never knew that the cow and the human, in fact, we're filled with biology of microorganisms. We got a couple of pounds of organisms on us, on every orifice. We're not by ourselves. In fact, the word human comes from the word humus. So some of us are just dirt on legs. And some of us are heavily tilled. I'm not gonna say who. Ladies and gentlemen, I have never would have understood that all of it's connected, all of it's one. It's the interconnectedness. Those organisms help with the water cycle. They help with everything, with nutrient uptake in our intestines and the plants. They're everywhere. When I heard Will Harris, the first thing that came out of my mind when I saw what he has done was the concept of relationship. He understood the relationship between his animals and everything around him, but more importantly, the relationship in the community. If we change the relationship and understand our context to the ecology, we can change the community. I am personally convinced if we all farmed like Will Harris, we would suck more money into rural America and bring it back. Now, if somebody would say to me, Ray, if you have one word for soil health, what would you call it? I would call it biomimicry. Mimic life. Can you imagine sitting by the plane and they say, Ray, what do? Oh, I teach how to mimic life. And can you imagine a rancher when he sits there and they ask him, what do? Instead of saying, I'm a rancher and a farmer, I mimic life. I have one of the most complex jobs in the world. It is more difficult than even rocket science. Rocket science is simple because I work with a living dynamic system. Here's what I suggest to write. Go on to TED and type the word biomimicry. There's 20 minutes of awesomeness there. There's a great 20-minute videos by Janine Benyus. She says there's 3.8 billion years of research and development. She is an awesome speaker. They have institutions of biomimicry. And this is my word, eco-mimicry. Eco means the house. That's where we get the word economics, the money of the house. Let me tell you how we can solve our problems by mimicking nature and watching and observe. Some of our best designs come from nature. An engineer learned how to create Velcro by his dog had a little burr on its fur, and he saw the hook. I said, hey, I'll make a tape that does that. Do you know what the name of that scientist is? Millionaire. Billionaire. We are using biomimicry. We mimic the termite mounds because their air conditioning system is so phenomenal. We're putting it in buildings and reducing our energy by 90%. Awesome. We are mimicking elephant trunks to create this awesome robotics. UPS and all these other companies are studying ants and bees and how they transport things back to the hive. We can solve our problems if we were humble enough to watch the creation and learn from it. In fact, it has been around for a long time. The book of Job, it says, ask the beast and they will tell you. They will teach you. Notice it didn't say, I want you to go get more yield out of it. It didn't say, force it. It says, observe and learn from it. She argues we need to mimic the prairie and the forest. Look at the architecture. We want to mimic. That's our systems, what we're doing now throughout the country. I will show you, because this is where we picked up our principles. They're self-evident. It is covered 24/7. It has diversity. They both have animals in both systems. Look at the difference. Now, some people say, hey, well, Ray, you're making all this up. You smoke way too much cover crops. Where do you get your science? Really? Look at the scientists I've known, Dr. Odom, Sowell, Piper. Applications and principles and patterns our nature have been known for a long, long time, but they are rarely applied in our agroecosystems. Ray is not smart enough to figure this out. We have brilliant scientists that knew this is the pattern. This is how we're doing our mixes. This afternoon, Gabe and I are going to talk about how we're going to design these mixes and how to emulate that. Different root depth. Each one gives a different exudate. They have different architecture. They're capturing energy differently. Where did we learn how to do that? Gabe and Jay went and heard Dr. Adamir Kalahari. We need to do mixes. Look how beautiful that we're restoring ecological memory. And when we do this, we help the insects. We help the beneficial insects. We help the wildlife. We have farmers now that don't use insecticides or fungicides anymore. Have you ever wondered why? See, bacteria can reproduce every 20 minutes. Why aren't we overrun by bacteria? Have we ever wondered why? Because insects can double in population in a couple of hours. Ladies and gentlemen, why aren't we overrun with insects? It is self-healing, self-regulating. All we got to do is provide the right circumstance. Weren't we taught that yesterday by some of the people about nutrition? Providing the right circumstance for our body to run on? Same thing with the natural ecosystem. This is the liquid carbon pathway, ladies and gentlemen. This is what we talked about. How are we going to heal it? I did this in the back of my garden. What I do is I get two clods of water, one on the right hand. You see my cover crop mix. The one on the left is corn. I am dunking in water. I call it the scum test, but I should really call it the liquid carbon pathway. Look at that white, frothy material. This is why I tell farmers, cover crops. They are not optional. Look at all the white substances you see. I sent it into the lab, had 170 parts per million carbon and 8 parts per million. Look at that white, frothy material. Are thousands of compounds that leak to the soil to feed biology. Plants will leak from 40 to 70% of their photosynthetic energy right into the soil to feed it. When you overgraze, you take away from the liquid carbon pathway. Doesn't make enough aggregates.
Cover crop rather than...
Let me show you here. Let me back up a little bit.
I'm gonna show you what farmers are doing out through the whole country now. We have thousands and thousands of acres going in and we're planting into it. This is Pennsylvania. We are doing green planting all over the country. This is Pennsylvania.
This big mat control. My first 12 rows is built.
Isn't this beautiful?
The newest thing in the industry here is to let our cover crops get real big and plant green into them. And this...
Ladies and gentlemen, this is where we're going. I want to see the rest of the whole country that farms, that we start planting our covers into standing covers. He is planting corn into standing cover. He is capturing energy to the last minute. He is feeding biology. As he lays that cover, he's mimicking nature because it has armor, keeping the soil temperatures cool. We're increasing yields, reducing herbicides, eliminating fungicides, eliminating insecticides, reducing our chemical nitrogen by mimicking the natural ecosystem. And we're having it on 1,000. Look at the soil on the left. That is Tennessee. That was 30 years of no-till. Look at the stratification. See, no-till was never really the answer. It was systems thinking. Look at the soil. That's the same soil. Look to the right. After 2 years of cover crop mixes, look at the cottage cheese. Look at the earthworms come back. See, no-till was never the answer. It was farming in nature's image was the answer. grazers. Also here, until you understand all those cycles, water cycle, nutrient cycle, and all these cycles, how are you going to learn how to reduce your inputs? Our job is to capture energy. Look at that sun. Look at the left when you overgraze, which in fact is the aggregation. We need to understand these cycles. How many of you have Alan Savory's book? Raise your hand. How many have actually read it? Buy the book. Read those first four chapters so you understand these processes. It changed me. Now let me show you how we're doing it in our livestock. We are mimicking biomimicry. Look what we're doing. These animals ran in huge herds. We are now running cattle. I like to call it adaptive grazing. Some days you'll group them up tight. Sometimes you'll give them more space. You'll do rotational. You adapt to the circumstance. You use them as a tool. Back then, they grouped up because of predators. The predator we use now is called the hot wire. See that red dot, that red cross right there? The way we all, most people graze, if you let the animals just loose out there, it would take 27 years, according to Missouri State University research, that you would get a cow pie in that spot. 27 years. See, the only way we're going to feed biology is when we do this. We got to impact every square foot of that soil with a urine patch and with manure to feed the micro herd. And they don't want the chemical fertilizer. They want manure, saliva, urine. This is what we want, ladies and gentlemen. And you don't have to do it all the time. That is feeding my microbes. This is Gabe's place. Gabe has a nice little spread. He can let the animals run everywhere. He's got the land for it. But he refuses to do that because he wants to restore ecological memory. Look how beautiful those cattle and how they are. And they're functioning as a unit. This is man's design. Gabe, the rest of the country. But people will say, but we got to feed the world. No, we don't. Let's teach them how to feed themselves. This is why cattle get such a bad rap. They don't know the real story. That's what we're talking about. To show you how powerful the animals are, ladies and gentlemen, how many of you have been to the Chihuahuan Desert? Raise your hand. It's pretty hot, doesn't it? I mean, my school was close to that. I mean, it's hot down there. Let me show you how powerful the biology is. Look how, when you do ultra-high stock density, run the animals, look what it's done in smothering out the mesquite. They told us in range science, you cannot smother out the mesquite because it's allelopathic. In a lot of these shrubs, they will not allow the grasses. Look at the grasses. Look at the cactus being smothered. Masanobu Fukuoka believed there was no such thing as deserts. He believed that deserts were man-made. This lends to his argument. Let me show you, when you guys get a chance, you need to watch this video called Cows, Key Line, and Restoring Desert Grasslands. Why is this video so important to me? I grew up in the West. It is personal to me when I drive home and go see my mom and dad that the land looks like this. We get only 12 inches of rain. Parts of Texas only get that much. They get rain and the water all runs off. Why? And look, they have massive erosion because of this. The soil is solarized. Solarization is when it's so compacted like this. In greenhouses, they use solarization to kill the weed seeds. This is the rangeland on millions of acres, compacted, crusted, no life. It is dormant state. Millions of acres throughout the, billions of acres throughout the planet looks like that. Look how this man used the right tools to restore it. Remember I was telling you about the creosote bush? We were told you can't grow anything between creosote bush. It's allelopathic. This man used the yeoman plow. Now, let me give you some context here. Notice he did not use a disc. He used something just to break the crust. He had to use hard impact, or he could use the piece of machine. Alan Savory, I got to talk to him about it, because he worked with Alan Savory. Alan said you could have done it with cattle. This man chose to use this yeoman plow, an old tractor, create a little slice, just break the crust, stimulate it just enough to stimulate secondary succession, get the weeds going, because that's the first thing you do when you do tillage, you stimulate secondary succession. Now, if you'd used the disc, he would have destroyed too much aggregates, and it would have been powder and would have been very destructive. But look what happened, just enough to capture the rain, and then he did mob grazing, and look what happened. Amazing when a man understands his tools. Not have a love affair with the tools, but understands the system. And then the wildlife came back, and everything, the insects and everything come back. I'm almost done, Gabe. I used to wake up, I love this statement by Gabe. He says, I used to wake up every morning trying to decide what I have to kill that day. That's modern agriculture. Now he wakes up every morning to see what he makes alive. I got to spend a couple of days with Gabe, and he took me around in his four-wheeler, and we got to go everywhere on his UTV. And I've been around a lot of farmers and ranchers. First thing he talked about is the tools and that. Gabe, all he talked about, let's go talk about the ecology, how we can connect the dots. Totally amazing. Gabe and I love this saying from Don Campbell. If you want to make small changes, change how you do things. When you want to make major changes, change how you see things. The last one, folks, last three or four slides. Remember I was telling you about human integrity. What does it mean by integrity? It adherence to moral principles, honesty. It's a wholeness. It's a soundness. We cannot build ecological integrity without this. These are the books, it's on my Facebook, that I read that have changed me. The first one gives me the why I'm here, why we are here. Gives me the context about human nature. Then the other book that changed me was Holistic Management. That was the first one that made me realize. Then all the ecology books I could read. And another Dr. Keller. Here's my Facebook, so that you can get all the list of all the books that I read that have absolutely changed the way I see things. Here's another book I deeply recommend. It's called The Bible and the Ecology. Reevaluating the biblical tradition of dominion. Even the church is taught wrong that we were talking about have dominion over that. To force it, it gives you the impression. But this book gives you a good insight. That was never the intent. We were supposed to be the viceroy and the ambassador here of this planet, not bad renters and kick the wall down. Excellent book, I recommend. And then Simon Sinek, I would recommend these two books. You can find them on YouTube. I definitely recommend that. Start with your why. Because today, what we're asking, I want you to walk away today, ladies and gentlemen. What we need is leaders. And one of the most profound, when I read his book, he said he's gone all over, Simon. He said the most leaders he found out in a given area was the Marine Corps. And he asked the Brigadier General, why do you have so many leaders coming out of your place? He said, Simon, it is simple. Simple, Simon. It is simple. He said, see, when you're a captain, all the soldiers eat first. And if you run out of food, the captain doesn't eat. Leaders eat last. Ladies and gentlemen, how many of us are willing to eat last, to sacrifice our names, to go and say we no longer accept the current modern agriculture model? Leaders make you feel safe. When you go to your neighbor, and we got to teach them, we need to make people feel safe. Not criticize them, teach them. Leaders make you feel safe, and they inspire. Conservation plans do not inspire no one. They don't. Last slide. Gabe's saying, thank God. Remember, if you don't like this talk, my name is Gabe Brown. When I heard Alan give this, I use this quite a bit, and I'm going to break the rules of PowerPoint, ladies and gentlemen. Too much text, and I'm going to read it directly to you. I used this in Wisconsin when I was in a group in front of very irritated producers. Half the room was dairymen, half the room were urbanites. The water was polluted, the lake was polluted, and people were angry. After I finished with the demonstrations, they began to calm down. And I finished this with the last slide. And I said, it is not about water quality. It is about understanding your why. Why do you do what you do? Some people say, when I say, why do you farm? Well, to make a living. No. Why did you get into farming? Because you loved it. Here's our why, ladies and gentlemen. It's not about grazing. It's not about no-till. It's not about the process and tools. And it's not about conservation plans. This is what it's about. We want stable families living peaceful lives in prosperity and physical security while free to pursue their own spiritual and religious beliefs. Adequate, nutritious food and clean water, enjoying good education and health, in balanced lives with time for family, friends, and community, all to be ensured for many generations to come on a foundation of regenerative living soils and biological diverse communities, land and her rivers, lakes, and oceans. Please raise your hand if you disagree with this phrase. We came to consensus. Do you know when I shared that with that group? There was no more fighting. They came to consensus. And it's simple, ladies and gentlemen. We just got to teach people how to love the land. Not to love it just because we're trying to save our own hide. That's not real love. We love it because we respect our community and each other. Then we will restore soil function, ladies and gentlemen. I want to thank you for having me today. Thank you very much.